Hey, this is Generation Next from the blog swordsofmax.wordpress.com. This is the fifth part to my response to Find Your Love in Japan's video, Three Questions for Black People in the U.S. I answered his other two questions in the last couple of videos, the last couple of parts. I must warn you, the responses are lengthy because I feel that the answers to those questions he had needed to be thoroughly explained. But you can listen to those videos to fully hear my response to some of the things he mentioned in his video. In this video, I will address your final question, Nobita. Why do you, black people, threaten someone who disagrees with you? Why do you get violent? This is a very interesting question. If you haven't noticed, most Americans threaten people they disagree with. It's not just black people. Americans are generally the type of people that use threats as an insult. Look at Logan Paul supporters and what they said of you. They told you to F yourself too, and all I heard from you is an apology. But just like you want black people to understand why Japanese people are scared of them, at least a little, you should understand why black people would be angrier than all the others. Because what you're saying is threatening to them. The ideas that you put out there are ideas that mimic racist times and eras. Eras that led to mass genocide, violence, oppression, and horrors unimaginable. The ideas of looking down on groups of people because of background led to Nazi Germany, Jim Crow, slavery, and what is stopping history from repeating itself? Just a drop of that ideology is threatening. And black people fear the worst from it because they have experienced the worst from it. That's why they reacted more aggressively than the others, because they feel threatened by these beliefs. As someone who has never been colonized, you are just like white people. Basically, you don't understand the horrors of colonization and forced assimilation. But those people who have been colonized fully understand the outcry some of your comments can cause, because they are clearly a reflection of ignorance, miseducation, and or misguidance, as well as taught imperialism. Now, I will admit that the reactions of black people may actually ignite, you know, the very issues black people truly want to prevent. You know, no one wants a real war. You know, consequences are too severe. No one really wants war. But, again, Nobita, you have to understand that you are on YouTube, an American website, and the culture is that way. I'm not a supporter of Black Lives Matter, but if you know anything about police and what they have done, just like black people do, how can you trust them? You're saying that Americans are wild and commit these crimes against police officers, but you don't know the horrors of what policemen have done. You know, American policemen aren't like Japanese policemen. In America, they vary more widely in their honor and morale. Look at the incidents that came out about the policemen in Baltimore. I'm sure you don't know anything about that. I'll share it in the descriptions. With these incidents, it's difficult to trust those in authority, those who are expected to uphold the law, you know, not encourage lawbreaking. You know, we have police officers who steal and sell drugs. We have police officers that take money. Our police officers vary in their morale, okay? Some Black Lives Matter supporters can be too violent for me, which isolates me from the movement as a whole, but can you blame some of them for wanting to retaliate against something they feel is unfair for them? They are angry and they're tired, and that leads to outrage and wild protests. And it's not a black thing to riot when they get in the heat of the moment. It's an American thing, honestly. Look at the huge riot that took place in Philadelphia, all because a football team won a game. We had people turning over cars, looting stores, setting things on fire, and all mostly white people. Let's just be real. American culture is this way. When we get a little too much freedom, some of us tend to run with it. You mentioned that black people should realize how lucky they are. Black people do realize how lucky they are. Of course, many of us are happy we live in the USA of all places and have certain freedoms and rights now, But we wouldn't have been as lucky if we hadn't fought for those rights to begin with just a little over 40 years ago. Yes, we have freedom of speech because we fought for the rights to have them. And we still have that freedom because we continue to fight for those rights. They weren't just handed to us. As I mentioned before, like you seem to think, Black people couldn't always speak up whenever they wanted, or they would have been shot and killed like Martin Luther King Jr. Black people ensured they got those rights. They ensured that justice was served. And by them protesting against even hints of racist ideologies, even today, they are ensuring they continue to have those rights because they've seen how easy it can be taken away from them. White people didn't give it to us and make us feel comfortable here. We fought for the lucky lives we're living. And yes, we show our appreciation for people who helped us get it by honoring days like Martin Luther King Jr. Day. Don't be ignorant and look at this superficially like you have been doing. Get down on a Black person's level. In fact, I dare you to live as a Black person does and see if you then feel there is so much equal opportunity. It won't be the same since you don't have the same ancestral connection, but somehow you need to be in someone else's shoes to understand them. Yes, no country is perfect, but Black people aren't either. We don't deserve disrespect. We don't deserve to be talked down to. Shouldn't we speak up and fight against this when we see it? Again, racism doesn't mean you hate Black people. You keep saying, I don't hate Black people. You don't have to hate Black people to be racist. It means you think they are inferior based on cultural differences. You can care immensely about Black people and still think they are inferior to your race. The definition has nothing to do with being nice. We're always nice to our dogs and cats as pets, but do we see them as equal to us as human beings, deserving the same rights? Most humans do not. That is the difference. Prejudice is when you prejudge a race, a group of people, without having any real experience with that group of people. Racism isn't the same as that. Racial hatred itself is not the full context of what racism is, if we're using the dictionary definition. It's evolving more than hatred. When it comes to racism, you may know a lot of Black people, even have Black friends and colleagues, may like a few of them, but based on your culture and what you think is morally right or just, you will still believe that one culture is inferior to your own. And as long as you carry that ideology with you, you will be labeled racist based on a dictionary fact. You may not like the label, but it describes you and so many other people who discriminate and look down on Black people for their background, culture, and color of skin. I don't care how you try to twist it. You don't understand why people kneel before the national anthem. I've seen some of your videos. You don't seem to understand that because you don't understand the horrors of colonialism. For you, that's not patriotic. It's a traitor. Well, if the British had made good on your people in the 1800s, they really made good on y'all? And had taken over Japan? Like in that analogy I spoke about a couple of videos ago? If they had really made good on you guys and took over Japan, and they established a national anthem in your country about freedom and liberty, but you Japanese were still being denied jobs, still being killed based on the color of your skin, and still impoverished in a country you built up or helped to build up, a country where you're native, would you just be grateful that the British let you live there? Would you just sing along blindly? You know, I really want to know your answer to this. Maybe you would. If the British had taken over Japan in the 1800s, would you be singing the new national anthem they established for you? Martin Luther King, a civil rights leader in the USA, a man who was honored, you know, who has been honored for the last couple of months. He was called an outside agitator whose demonstration, this peaceful, nonviolent demonstration, mind you, was unwise and untimely. That he was called this by white clergymen. Martin Luther King responded by saying, "We know through painful experience that freedom is never voluntarily given by the oppressor, but demanded by the oppressed. We know through painful experience that freedom is never voluntarily given." He also said, "Frankly, I have yet to engage in a direct action campaign that was well-timed in the view of those who have not suffered unduly from the disease of segregation. For years now, I have heard the word wait. It rings in the ear of every Negro with piercing familiarity. This wait has almost always meant never. We must come to see with one of our distinguished jurists that justice too long delayed is justice denied. We have waited for more than 340 years, and for us Black people, longer than that, for our constitutional and God-given rights. The nations of Asia and Africa are moving with jet-like speed toward gaining political independence, but we still creep at horse and buggy pace toward gaining a cup of coffee at a lunch counter. Perhaps it is easy for those who have never felt the stinging darts of segregation to say, wait. But when you have seen vicious mobs lynch your mothers and fathers at will and drown your sisters and brothers at whim, when you have seen hate-filled policemen curse, kick, and even kill your Black brothers and sisters, when you see the vast majority of your 20 million Negro brothers smothering in an airtight cage of poverty in the midst of an affluent society, when you suddenly find your tongue twisted and your speech stammering as you seek to explain to your six-year-old daughter why she can't go to the public amusement park that has just been advertised on television, and see tears welling up in her eyes when she is told that Funtown is closed to colored children, and see ominous clouds of inferiority beginning to form in her little mental sky, and see her beginning to distort her personality by developing an unconscious bitterness toward white people. When you have to concoct an answer for a five-year-old son who is asking, Daddy, why do white people treat colored people so mean? When you take a cross-country drive and find it necessary to sleep night after night in the uncomfortable corners of your automobile because no motel will accept you. When you are humiliated day in and day out by nagging signs reading white and colored. When your first name becomes nigger and your middle name becomes boy, however old you are. And your last name becomes John, and your wife and mother are never given the respective title, Mrs. When you are harried by day and haunted by night by the fact that you are a Negro, living constantly at tiptoe stance, never quite knowing what to expect next, and are plagued with inner fears and outer resentments. When you are forever fighting a degenerating sense of nobodiness, then you will understand why we find it difficult to wait. First, I must confess that over the past few years, I have been gravely disappointed with the white moderate. This is what Martin Luther King Jr. has said, and I'm quoting him. I have almost reached the regrettable conclusion that the Negro's great stumbling block in his stride toward freedom is not the white citizen's counselor or the Ku Klux Klanner, but the white moderate, who is more devoted to order than to justice, who prefers a negative peace, which is the absence of tension, to a positive peace, which is the presence of justice, who constantly says, I agree with you in the goal you seek, but I cannot agree with your methods of direct action, who paternalistically believes he can set the timetable for another man's freedom, who lives by a mythical concept of time, and who constantly advises the Negro to wait for a more convenient season. Shallow understanding from people of goodwill is more frustrating than absolute misunderstanding from people of ill will. Lukewarm acceptance is much more bewildering than outright rejection. You are exactly as Dr. King describes. You have goodwill, but you have shallow understanding of Black people, and it's more frustrating than absolute misunderstanding from people who want to do us harm. Lukewarm acceptance, like yours, Nobita, is much more bewildering than some nationalistic racist outright rejection, because the moderates are more devoted to order than justice. The person who says, I agree with you in the goal you seek, but I cannot agree with your methods of direct action. We don't need people like that. Those people are not allies of ours. Those people just want us to stop bothering them. They don't really care how long we have to wait to be treated fairly. And they're ignorant of just how many unfair situations there are that Black people are presented with today. Nobita, I was just like you once upon a time, and I'm Black. I used to blame my fellow Black people for the situation that they are in. I used to hate my own people because my community was filled with violence and crime. I used to hate my own people because they bullied me for being different. I used to hate my own hair because I hate going to hair salon because it takes too long. But when I didn't, people would talk about how nappy my hair was and how I needed a relaxer and how I needed to straighten it. I used to want to be white. I used to want to be Japanese. I used to want to be any race besides my own. What would make me lack so much confidence in myself? Again, when you look at things on a superficial level, then you can't see the cycles that continue, and then you can't ever really break them. I wanted to change my life, and in the process, I discovered why Black people are what they are today. I knew my history probably a lot more than you did, so I wasn't even as ignorant to it as you are, but I was still ignorant because I wasn't asking the fundamental deductive questions, questions that are important when trying to understand a situation. The difference between you and me is that I aim to help my Black community, so it gave me a reason to dig a little deeper. You? I'd be lucky if I get a view or listen from you. I'd be lucky if anyone besides Black people even watches this. Whenever there's a subject on race, usually it's mostly Black people listening. Other people tend to find we don't have validity to what we say. And it's sad because they need to listen to it the most. White people and Japanese people like you, and certain races, white people, I should say, they mistake our speaking out as if we're looking for white people to help us or pay reparations or apologize. That's not what Black people want from white people. What Black people want is for white people to understand what we're fighting for and why. Not to belittle our experiences just because you don't experience it. And we want to be treated like equals and not be ignored because of the color of our skin, even though we may have all the qualifications and more than our peers. See the article, White People Do Nice Things for Each Other and That's Bad. We want our children to have access to education equal to that of white people so that they can have the qualifications, so that they can succeed. We want white people to recognize that by telling Black people to reconstruct the Black community all on their own while still living in impoverished states due to over 100 years of racism and oppression from the 1960s and back and forward is equivalent to damaging a car and then telling the person whose car you damaged to fix it themselves. We need white people to stand with us, not against us, to help us fix what was destroyed, particularly by the government. In regards to Black Lives Matter, Black people are tired of being profiled, and there are people who think we need better ways of handling unarmed Black civilians from police officers. We want representation in media that shows us in a positive light overseas. We want our culture respected and not diminished or tarnished by other people. We want credit for the things that we have created and accomplished, such as our contribution and creation of much of what is now considered modern music. And we want what the government has owed us since supposedly freeing us from slavery, for them to keep their promises and to give us our 40 acres and a mule. Because that's what the government promised us, 40 acres and a mule. Why is it that the Japanese and Native Americans got reparations for the internment camps and the reservations, but Black people got nothing? Is that fair? This is all we ask. To stand with us, not against us, on the basis of our skin color. Treat us equally and give us what they promise. I understand that white people wouldn't want to stand with people who seem to hate them. Yes, there are people in Black Lives Matter and other Black groups who do just hate white people based on their experiences with white people or based on what they have learned and heard about white people. I understand that can make things difficult, but this has nothing to do with groups or communities organizing. Let's look past Black Lives Matter, that one group, because the average Black person really isn't involved in this movement. It goes much deeper than that. The heart of all of these movements is a need for white people to understand how the Black community has been affected and infected by racism. At the heart of all of these movements, that's what it's about. Because at the end of the day, when it's all said and done, it won't matter how white people feel, because white people are going to have everything they need. Because their ancestors made this country very comfortable for them and very uncomfortable for us. I'm not saying white people deserve to be treated unfairly or deserve to be hated upon. No one deserves that. But I'm saying that Black people care about their lives, and any other Black group that springs up is really a result of a much deeper issue that sprang up from segregation, discrimination, oppression, colonialism, and imperialism that happened in the past and infected Black communities, along with other communities of color. And I use the word infected because these issues in the past created the disease that we see in the Black community today. And that's just the truth of the matter. These groups are one facet of groups that are fighting for civil rights. We still have the NAACP and others, but Black Lives Matter is most visible because they're making the loudest noise. But if they didn't, would other people even recognize that there are issues still plaguing the Black community? You can say what you want about Black Lives Matter, but before that group, white people ignored the other Black civil rights groups. White people stayed in their safe bubbles until Black Lives Matter showed up. Black Lives Matter, they're making the loudest noise because that's the only way to get the oppressor's attention. That's the only way to get some of these people's attention. And in truth, not everyone who professed to be supporters of Black Lives Matter were really a part of the movement. Just like a lot of white nationalists and neo-Nazis are pro-Trump and say Trump is our president, it doesn't mean that Trump is a white nationalist or neo-Nazi. It doesn't mean that everyone who's pro-Black Lives Matter or who claim to be, you know, representatives of the movement and its leaders doesn't mean they really are. There are plenty of Black Lives Matter protests that were peaceful, too. You know, not all Black Lives Matter protests were violent. So many of them were peaceful. It just didn't make front page news because obviously scandal and chaos makes better news. Overall, sitting in the corner and quietly saying we want rights doesn't get anyone anywhere in this country. It never has. And we can tell it doesn't by observing even the Native Americans. They have civil rights organizations like NARF, NCAI, NICWA, and all of their protests have been peaceful, but what has that done for them? They are still in the same reservations and impoverished situations that they have been since this land was taken from them. They are progressing, but their issues are not publicized as much, so progress is slower. They still lack proper representation in their own land, and people still think they are out of some fairy tale book like Peter Pan. White people, racist white people, are still saying, get over it. You were conquered. It's our land now. All quiet protests have done is allow racist white people to ignore issues they've caused and continue to cause. They love to put a fancy rug over a dirty floor instead of cleaning the mess up because they are afraid of facing their own ugly mirror and taking responsibility. Nobita, you live in a homogeneous world, and I doubt you will ever understand the effects of colonialism, British and American imperialism, and the impact it has had on countries like Canada, USA, South Africa, plenty of other African countries, and India today. These same imperialistic people brought multiculturalism to the world and then turned around and said they wanted a white ethnostate out of countries they took from people of color. You can't understand how harsh that is until you live it. But hopefully, I hope you at least understand where Black people are coming from just a little bit more in this debate. And I hope you'll think about what you've said in the future. And I hope you think about the questions that you've had just a little bit more. And I hope you'll seek to do your research a little bit more and learn more about Black people, you know, on your own. And not let these cherry, you know, pick stats influence you. So that's where I'm going to end this, these answers. That's where I'm going to end this discussion. If there's anything that still causes confusion, please feel free to message me or even comment. And that's all. This is Sora Jin next, signing out, over and out.